Developing a Supernatural Lifestyle, a practical guide to a life of signs, wonders, and miracles, by Kris Vallotton, narrated by John Mohr. Introduction. In the days of Elijah the prophet, there arose a company of men who were called the sons of the prophets. These men traveled throughout the world, ravaging the powers of darkness and wreaking havoc on evil kingdoms. They had no tolerance for the destructive behavior of wicked kings, but rather turned many to righteousness. They raised the dead, healed the sick, parted rivers, destroyed false prophets, and saw revival spread throughout their land. They were feared by many and respected by all. They walked in great purity, and God was their friend. Today, all around us, wickedness continues to grow, taking root in the lives of those we love and eroding the very foundation of our country. Satanism is spreading like wildfire. Psychics laugh in the face of the church as they demonstrate the power of the dark side. Divorce is destroying our families and violence our children. Cancer, AIDS, other diseases take the lives of so many. Yet the words of our Lord Jesus echo throughout the halls of history. These signs will follow those who believe. And greater works than these will you do, because I go to the Father. Mark 16:17. John 14:12. In Acts 3:25, Peter says, "It is you who are the sons of the prophets." It is time for the body of Christ to rise up and receive our inheritance. We must rid ourselves of complacency and restore the ancient boundaries of holiness and demonstrations of great power. We cannot be satisfied with illustrated sermons, great music, and friendly services. We have been called to see the powers of darkness destroyed and our ruined cities restored. In the days of Moses, God demonstrated his power to Pharaoh. But Pharaoh counterattacked by having his sorcerers duplicate the miracles of God. Then the God of heaven, who has all power, performed extraordinary miracles so that even the sorcerers said, "This must be God. We cannot perform these miracles." Finally, Pharaoh was overcome by God's power and let his people go. I believe that the Pharaoh of this world is about to let go of our cities as God demonstrates his raw, superior power through his church. We are in the midst of the greatest revival in human history, yet there remains a distance between what should be and what will be. That distance is you. What will you be? You are the bridge between history and his story. You are the sons of the prophets. The sick, the demonized, the poor, the blind, the lame, and the lost are all waiting to see what you have learned. Don't disappoint them. Introduction. In the days of Elijah the prophet, there arose a company of men who were called the sons of the prophets. These men traveled throughout the world, ravaging the powers of darkness and wreaking havoc on evil kingdoms. They had no tolerance for the destructive behavior of wicked kings, but rather turned many to righteousness. They raised the dead, healed the sick, parted rivers, destroyed false prophets, and saw revival spread throughout their land. They were feared by many and respected by all. They walked in great purity, and God was their friend. Today, all around us, wickedness continues to grow, taking root in the lives of those we love and eroding the very foundation of our country. Satanism is spreading like wildfire. Psychics laugh in the face of the church as they demonstrate the power of the dark side. Divorce is destroying our families and violence our children. Cancer, AIDS, other diseases take the lives of so many. Yet the words of our Lord Jesus echo throughout the halls of history. These signs will follow those who believe. And greater works than these will you do, because I go to the Father. Mark 16:17, John 14:12. In Acts 3:25, Peter says, "It is you who are the sons of the prophets." It is time for the body of Christ to rise up and receive our inheritance. We must rid ourselves of complacency and restore the ancient boundaries of holiness and demonstrations of great power. We cannot be satisfied with illustrated sermons, great music, and friendly services. We have been called to see the powers of darkness destroyed and our ruined cities restored. In the days of Moses, God demonstrated his power to Pharaoh, but Pharaoh counterattacked by having his sorcerers duplicate the miracles of God. Then the God of heaven, who has all power, performed extraordinary miracles so that even the sorcerer said, "This must be God. We cannot perform these miracles." Finally, Pharaoh was overcome by God's power and let his people go. I believe that the Pharaoh of this world is about to let go of our cities as God demonstrates his raw, superior power through his church. We are in the midst of the greatest revival in human history, yet there remains a distance between what should be and what will be. That distance is you. What will you be? You are the bridge between history and his story. You are the sons of the prophets. The sick, the demonized, the poor, the blind, the lame, and the lost are all waiting to see what you have learned. Don't disappoint them. Chapter 1. History Makers. Every so often in the course of history, there are individuals born who defy common reason and statistical explanation. These are the great ones, who break the tether of their generational expectations and rise to the call that seems to echo from somewhere beyond the grave. The prophets of old peered into the future and spoke of these valiant ones who would force their way into the kingdom, take hold of heaven, and pull it down to earth. These reigning saints refuse to have their exploits be a mere reflection of the past, but instead break the gravitational barriers of naysayers and doubters, journeying far beyond the boundaries of reason into places where no one has ever gone before. Ultimately, they capture the prize of the upward call of God that lies in Christ Jesus. These are God's history makers, the Lord's chosen people, his mighty men, his holy nation. Many of us can feel the vacuum of this vortex drawing our hearts into this divine destiny. We find our inner man longing, stirring, and burning for the great adventure. Live or die, we must press through the walls of mediocrity and find the promised land of our souls. We live with a passion to be numbered among those who have gained fame in the halls of heaven and are feared among the prison guards of hell. If we are going to walk as God's ruling royalty, it is incumbent upon us to pray unceasingly, give sacrificially, dream unreasonably, serve wholeheartedly, love unashamedly, walk innocently, believe undoubtingly, and live powerfully. These are the qualities of the bride of Christ in all her glory. She is called to be the most creative force on the face of the earth. Therefore, we must not allow ourselves to become known for our boxes, that is, famous for what we don't do because of our righteous constrictions. Abraham Lincoln, George Washington, and Benjamin Franklin had certain moral values that restrained their behavior. But they were famous for what they did, not for what they didn't do. It would be tragic if the most creative people on the face of the earth allowed themselves to be reduced to rent-a-cops guarding a box, the Ark of the Covenant, that God vacated 2,000 years ago. The truth is that if we don't take our rightful place in the earth, we will relegate sinners void of the mind of Christ, barred from the wisdom of the ages, and wandering in utter darkness, to being the most brilliant minds of our time. If the brightest light in our world belongs to those locked in darkness, how great would the darkness be in our world? Something is fundamentally wrong with this picture. But this is our brain on religion. Religion is like kryptonite to Superman. Religion can conform the most righteous, reigning saints into mindless zombies, puppets, repeating someone else's convictions they don't even understand themselves. Attack of the Clones. I am convinced that religion is the father of genetic cloning. Religion invented cloning long before the world ever thought of it. Religion has a way of sucking the most powerful people on the planet into a spiritual look-alike contest and calling it discipleship. True discipleship is meant to empower people to be transformed into the image of their Creator. But religion redefines the terms, conforming people into replicas of their leaders. Religion takes God's mighty men and makes them artifacts in a museum. Religious people, like the Pharisees of old, have the hardest time reaching out to folks who think outside the box and don't behave inside their hopeless shackles. Part of the struggle comes from what they've done to the Savior of the world. They have sterilized the gospel. Jesus took water and turned it into wine. But 2,000 years later, today's Pharisees have diluted it into grape juice. Religion has reduced the supernatural power of God to a history lesson about serving the dead body of a helpless Christ who, still nailed to the cross, is incapable of rocking their sacred boat. They emphasize the drowning of baptism, arguing over how people should get wet and what should be said over them during their dipping. Religious people have lost touch with the fact that the bold print of baptism is not on the descent, but on the ascension. The death of Christ paid for our sins, but it was His resurrection that gave life to our mortal bodies. Religion embraces death sadistically and moves the risen Christ out of the garden and back to the tomb. Religious people pray things like, "God, kill me," not realizing that even the one who came to give His life as a ransom for us all prayed, "Father, if You are willing, remove this cup of death from me. Yet, not my will, but Yours be done." Luke 22:42. Jesus did not want to die. He wanted to do His Father's will. If religion had its way, it would rewrite Mary's proclamation to read, "He is in the tomb, just where we laid Him." We have lost sight of the fact that the cross was for the old man, not the new man, and that the true Christian life is not about dying for Christ, but living in the life He...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.